All right, thanks for coming out, everybody. I'm Andrew Mann. I'm a master's student in the Forest Sciences program here. Today's speaker is Dr. Camille Stevens-Rumann. Her research focuses on better understanding both direct and indirect impacts of disturbances to enhance forest resilience and management in our changing world. Her talk today is titled Faltering Tree Regeneration in the Face of Fire and Climate Change. So with that, will you please join me in welcoming Dr. Camille Stevens-Rumann.
Thanks everybody for coming. So obviously I'm going to be talking about tree regeneration post-wildfire and thinking about the potential effects and some of the effects we're already seeing in relation to climate change. And ultimately this really has to do with the idea of resilience, right? Are our forests resilient to these disturbances? And that's, as foresters, researchers, and managers, this is a big thing of what we are concerned about, is are we going to continue to see forests where we have seen them over the last 100 years. So to start us off thinking about what resilience means, I have a couple definitions. So resilience is the ability of an ecosystem to recover from a disturbance, whereas resistance is the ability for an ecosystem to remain relatively unchanged from a disturbance. And I know a lot of you have probably seen the ball and cup model of resilience, you know, where you have an ecosystem that's staying within a ball or within a cup as a ball. And if you are a non-resilient system, you're perhaps moving out of that cup into some subsequent state or ecosystem type. But I want to talk about resilience. Some people call this engineering resilience or engineered resilience, so that we can actually talk about some of the mechanisms that control resilience or that we can measure that perhaps are speaking to an ecosystem resilience. So on the y-axis here we have ecosystem properties. This can be a lot of things. You could talk about it in terms of fuel loads, perhaps accumulating through time if you're an undisturbed system, or basal area accumulating or increasing through time, and net primary productivity perhaps changing through time, and then, you know, to some degree species diversity. And of course this isn't a perfectly linear line in all ecosystems, but to simplify it, if we have a disturbance, the idea is that if you're a resilient system, those ecosystem properties kind of drop off for a while, or you have a trough as a result of that disturbance. But then you are recovering and continuing along the similar successional trajectory, right, of that ecosystem. If you're resistant, the idea is that the trough of this disturbance, or you could think about it in terms of either the intensity or severity of this disturbance, is decreased or less than it would be if it was a non-resistant system. And again, if it's resilient, we're recovering and continuing along a similar trajectory. If you're a non-resilient system, instead you're transitioning, you experience some disturbance and you're transitioning off into some new ecosystem type. This could be transitioning from a mixed conifer forest to perhaps a grassland or a shrubland, or it could simply be perhaps losing one or two of the species of that forest, or perhaps transitioning into a different forest type. We can also apply this idea to the idea of repeated disturbances, right? Our landscapes are seeing multiple disturbances. So you can have an ecosystem that perhaps is resilient to multiple or both disturbances in this case, or that are perhaps you are surviving or doing well and recovering well after that first disturbance, but either because the severity or the time between those disturbances is too close, you're now, after a subsequent disturbance, transitioning into a non-resilient state and perhaps into a different ecosystem type. I'm going to talk about three different studies that kind of relate to different aspects of this resilience idea. And the first is measuring resilience through tree regeneration. So the questions that we asked for this study were, is tree regeneration following large wildfires perhaps changing or becoming less reliable because of a warming climate? And especially looking at since 2000, is this new century, a new era of climate change kind of changing that, those tree regeneration patterns? And also, is the role of climate actually influencing or changing the effect of other factors that we know is important in tree regeneration, right? Is climate kind of dwarfing those other factors that might be important when we think about tree regeneration? For example, distance to seed source or burn severity is really important when we talk about fire. And then as we think about managing these landscapes, what areas are of particular interest when we think about vulnerability? You know, is this effect of perhaps faltering tree regeneration uniform across the board, or is there some areas that are particularly of concern or of particular concern? So to do this, we did this across, is a study across a pretty wide range from here in Colorado all the way up to the Glacier National Park along the Canada-Montana border. And it includes a few different forest types. So we have pretty dry forest types like dry ponderosa pine and dry mixed conifer throughout Idaho and Wyoming. And then also we looked at some pretty wet and moist forested ecosystems as well. And this would include forest types like subalpine fir, spruce fir forests, larch in some cases. So in addition to a big geographic range, we also have a pretty big spread in time since fire. So our earliest fires were in 1988, the Yellowstone fires, and then the most recent fires we looked at were from 2011. And this kind of shows how our sites break out by those, by year and forest type. So to think about this data in a different way, this is looking at how those sites look in terms of a climate space. So those sites on the left or on your right here are the cool wet sites. So those make sense that most of the moist conifer forests are in this zone, whereas the drier forest types that are experiencing drier conditions generally, of course, are those dry conifer forests. The important thing here is that even though we identified or split them out here as dry ponderosa pine forests versus dry mixed conifer, they actually, for the most part, are experiencing some pretty similar effects, both here in Colorado and, or similar climate here in Colorado and in Idaho. So I won't get into too much of the field work and all of the sites that we, all the various methods that we used for this analysis, but I will say that this is a compilation of 1,400 plots, so pretty labor intensive, and the actual measuring and aging of over 62,000 seedlings. And to simplify this data, because we have kind of varying plot sizes between the different researchers, as well as really variable seedling densities from obviously no seedlings on a site to as many as 2 million per hectare. We simplified this to just be whether or not a site had seedlings present or absent, or whether they met some density threshold. And we define this density threshold as whether or not the site has the same number of seedlings as trees per hectare pre-fire. So pretty coarse measure, but is it at least having the same number of seedlings as were there before, or as there were trees before the fire? And this is a compilation of multiple people's dissertations and projects, including Carrie Kemp, Brian Harvey, Dan Donato, Monica Rother, and then additional master's works of Tom Veblen, Phil Higuera, and Penny Morgan's students. So when we think about what effect climate might be having on these sites, this is looking at the mean annual water deficit across these across all of our sites for our time period that we're looking at, right? Remember, we have fires that started in 1988 all the way to 2011. And you can see that before 2000, with some exceptions, right, 1988 with the Yellowstone fires was a pretty dry year, but in general it was kind of a wetter and cooler period compared to post 2000, where we don't even have, you know, we only have 3 years that are above the average of this climate window. So we chose to split the data into these two timeframes to look at perhaps if there's different patterns in tree regeneration before 2000 versus after 2000 with this drying period. And to get in some to get into some results. If we look at, this is, so pre-2000 is on the left and post-2000 is on the right. And the black is those that did not meet this density threshold. So we go from about 30% of the plots that did not meet the threshold to almost 60, it's I think 56% of the sites that didn't meet the threshold. So it's quite of a difference, right? We're talking about a third of our landscapes to more than 50% of the landscapes not regenerating enough to meet this density threshold. If we think about this by forest type, so this is just showing those that the number of sites that met that threshold, with these dark bars indicating the dry conifer forests, and that includes the ponderosa pine sites, and then these lighter gray with dots being the moist conifer forests. And you go from, even if you just look at seedling presence and absence, right? We're seeing a decline in the number of sites that have any seedlings present. And that most of this is, even though the pattern is consistent across forest type, the majority of sites that don't have seedlings are those drier forest types. So we're losing kind of those lower elevational forests to these disturbances potentially. To look at this a little bit differently in a geographic sense, so this is across eras, so it's just across our whole time frame, looking at what proportion of sites, according to the area geographically, do not have seedlings and do have seedlings. So you can see that kind of the most southerly ranges of these sites tend to have slightly fewer seedlings present. But in general, this pattern is consistent across the geographic range, right? Even though this pattern is largely driven by the dry mixed conifer forests and ponderosa pine forests, it's consistent across geography that there is only about 50% of those sites having any seedlings on them. So if we think about this in terms of climate space, this is a metric of 3-year post-fire climate as a z-score. So this is actually looking at whether or not that those post-fire conditions are cooler or wetter or drier or warmer than the average of those sites, right? So it's not just if they had moist conditions in those 3 years post-fire, but rather if they were wet compared to their own average. And we see that the sites that had seedlings present are at least, there's a lot of noise in there, but are at least slightly better, are experiencing slightly better conditions than those sites that have no seedlings present. And this kind of makes sense when you think about the pattern that we're seeing between pre-2000 and post-2000, right? Because if you're thinking about a 3-year post-fire climate in this time period, there's hardly any 3 years in this period that's going to actually be favorable compared to even this 30-year mean, right? Because there's so many years that were dry. So if we refer back to our resilience theory graph, what this means, if we apply some numbers to it, if there was a fire that happened before 2000, there appears to be about 70% of sites that are recovering to similar type forests, right? And there's 30% of sites that are perhaps transitioning to an alternate ecosystem, whether that be reduced densities or perhaps a non-forested vegetation type. After 2000, this changes to about 46% of sites that are retaining some of those resilient qualities versus 54% of those sites that are transitioning to a non-resilient state. And of course, some of this has to do with time since fire. But we did, because in some cases we only have 3 to 4, 5 years post-fire between when the fire happened and when sampling occurred. But we did some studies using the earlier fires to see how well the establishment in the first 5 years would predict the 20-year densities. And the R-squareds were really high, as they were 0.88 for all of across our sites in terms of predicting what those stands look like 20 years post-fire. So perhaps we're not seeing this transition to a non-resilient state as becoming all shrubland, but they're certainly not becoming as dense of forests as they were before, or at least there's a delay in that. So the one thing that I didn't really have a good visual for was that the long-term climatic trends tend to dwarf other factors that are influencing tree regeneration in that later period. So, you know, in the early period, we see things like distance to seed source and burn severity impacting the number of seedlings on the site. After 2000, there's the only significant influencing factor is the 30-year climatic record. So, and obviously the most vulnerable forest types are those dry forest types. And especially on those sites, the combination of these disturbances, some have called them mega disturbances, which we'll talk about a little bit later, is actually maybe accelerating those vegetation changes while we expect the climate window to perhaps exceed those forest types in 50 or 100 years. The fact that there's a fire that's killing most of the overstory trees is accelerating some of those vegetation changes now in these lower elevation marginal forests. So then all of this leads to thinking about what does it mean for a repeated disturbance, right? So we talked about a single wildfire, and perhaps you can think about it, a repeated disturbance in terms of the combination of climate and fire. But if you talk about two discrete events, what does this mean? So because we're here in Colorado, we have to mention the bark beetle. Right? But there's obviously multiple disturbance agents. I'm talking today mostly about fire, but there's obviously multiple things, disturbances that can be interacting. And in fact, both bark beetles and wildfires are increasing in size and number and severity across the western U.S. So even though there's not a whole lot of areas where we're seeing these disturbances interact right now, the likelihood of these disturbances interacting in the future is going to just continue to increase as we have these larger spatial scale disturbances. So when we think about interacting disturbances, there's a couple ways to think about it. You can think about it in terms of how a previous event is going to be influencing the actual subsequent event. You know, is a previous fire or a previous bark beetle outbreak influencing how subsequent fires are burning? Or you could think about it in terms of how those repeated or compounding disturbances are influencing the post-disturbance recovery period. And again, this really leads to thinking about what areas do we need to think about managing or be concerned about as these fires or other disturbances are interacting. And again, this really is another metric of how resilient are these forests to repeated disturbances. So this first part of it was we looked at how the influences of a previous fire influenced a subsequent fire. To answer the question, was the burn severity of subsequent fires influenced by previous wildfires? So was that previous event actually changing how the subsequent event burned? And we did this on three large wildfires. It's not necessarily important which wildfires they are, but I kind of wanted to show you some visuals of what kind of the overlap that we're looking at. In this case, there wasn't a whole lot of overlap. This fire pretty much burned in between or next to a lot of those previous wildfires. The dark gray is the fire we were interested in. This one and the next one both have quite a bit of overlap. These are pretty large fires in Idaho, and the wildfires burned through quite a few past burn severities. And this one is the same. It's in pretty close to the same geographic range as the previous one. And again, we see a lot of overlap. So the main conclusions here, when we refer back to this figure, is that if it burned at all in a previous event, regardless of how it burned less severely in the subsequent event. So compared to an unburned system here in white and red, those areas that burned previously appeared to be a little bit more resistant to a subsequent burn, right? They're burning less severely. And this happened whether it burned previously at low severity or high severity. And this is a little different than some of the other studies that have been done on this, particularly in California, where they found that high-severity wildfires actually led to subsequent high-severity wildfires. And this is, for the most part, due to a shift in vegetation, where those communities have a really big shrub component. And so those areas are turning into these really flammable shrub fields, and of course are going to burn again at high severity, where we don't really have that. All these fires were in the Pacific Northwest, or Idaho and Washington. So most of the understory is grass and perhaps a small component of shrubs. So we didn't really see that happening. And then the question leads, so okay, they burned at lower severity. And there's also been studies that have shown that perhaps they're actually stopping or good, relatively good barriers to other, to subsequent fires. But what does that mean in terms of thinking about the resilience of these ecosystems? How are they recovering after that subsequent disturbance, right? So are the areas that are burning at some high severity combination maintaining their resilience and continuing on the similar trajectory, or are they transitioning? Similarly, if you're burning at low severity combination, are you maintaining or transitioning? So for this, our big question was, how are vegetation and fuels altered by repeated fires or repeated burns? And as we go through this and we talk about resilience, I want to point out that here we're not talking about this binary thing, but actual species density and tree seedling density, so that, and fuels as well, so that kind of changes a little bit of the answer. But these are a couple examples of the burn landscapes, and we'll come back to these pictures in a minute. But for this, we just looked at two of those three wildfires that I previously showed, the ones that had the most interaction. And we looked at both multiple times since fire and also multiple combinations of severity, right? So we had areas that only burned once at either low severity or high severity. And then we had sites that burned at some combination of severities, right? So areas that burned twice at low severity, areas that burned twice at high severity, and areas that burned at some combination of low and high severity. So this is looking at seedling density, right? So this is high severity, low, and then the combination of multiple fires. And this is the various species. So the black is in lodgepole, is lodgepole. The white is ponderosa pine. The gray bars are Douglas fir, or gray stripes. The subalpine fir is the dots, and the top is all other species. And the big thing here that I want to point out is that there's a really big difference between areas that burned only once at low severity and those that burned twice at low severity. And the other thing to mention here, so this is a log scale, so this isn't actually seedlings per hectare, but it's log transformed seedlings, because there was, again, a lot of variability here, and this showed the differences a little bit better. But when we look at these two, what's happening here is that for the most part we're seeing a decline in lodgepole pine. So a lot of these areas had, whether they were originally dominated by lodgepole pine or not, there's been lodgepole encroachment in a lot of these areas. And so they're actually experiencing at post just one fire, that we're getting these carpets of lodgepole pine forest. But after a second low severity fire, we're kind of taking out at least a proportion of that. And we're actually seeing a higher proportion of ponderosa pine coming into those ecosystems, which for dry conifer forests is kind of what we're hoping for as managers. The other interesting thing is that even though there were declines, except for this combination of seedlings following repeated disturbances, the biggest differences we saw were in areas that burned originally at high severity. And this makes sense if you think about that these fires are between 1 and 18 years since the previous fire, and in most cases there isn't enough of a seed source to continue to allow those areas to regenerate after a subsequent disturbance. So kind of regardless of how you burned in the subsequent event, if you experienced an original high severity fire, you're not going to be seeing a whole lot of regeneration coming back, except of course for lodgepole, right? And this is where we see some of the biggest proportions of lodgepole pine seedlings, because a lot of those have, especially on the older sites, have reached maturity and they have a seed source. So when we think about coarse woody debris, for those of you who don't know what coarse woody debris is, it's any piece of wood larger than 3 inches in diameter, dead and down material. And of course, as we would expect, right, the highest loadings are areas that experienced only one high severity fire, right? Because all those trees are dying and then subsequently falling to the ground, kind of accumulating those surface fuel loads. But interestingly, some of the lowest fuels were actually seen on areas that experienced two high severity fires, right? Because we're seeing one fire that's killing all the trees, that's taking them to the ground, and then a subsequent fire is actually consuming a lot of that dead biomass. And in fact, it's consuming so much that it has a similar fuel loading as those areas that burned only once or twice at low severity, right? So we're talking about areas that have hardly any fuel loading. And to give you a little bit of visual of what these look like, this is what those stands look like. So if any of you have ever worked in burned areas, this is like the ideal place to work in because you have nothing to walk over. But it's kind of depressing as well because, again, there's no seedlings. And most of them did look something like this. We did have some sites that looked more like this. So there's no tree seedlings coming back. But there is some pretty big shrub component. You can see my field technician in there working. So this is one of those combinations of high and low severity. So you can see that before the subsequent fire, we had quite a few lodge poles here, right? We have a pretty thick stand of now ghost baby lodgepole trees. But then after this event, right, even though it was low severity in terms of, or low intensity fire, right, didn't consume a lot of this biomass, it did kill all those lodgepoles. But it's not necessarily a dire situation here. You can see in this picture there's at least a few seedlings coming back. So this lodgepole pine forest is still probably going to be there. But the density of that lodgepole, at least in the short term, is going to be much less. And then, of course, we have to have the perfect, you know, low severity adapted forest types with the beautiful wildflowers. And these are kind of the areas that burned repeatedly at low severity, right? So we're taking out that huge pulse of lodgepole pine and tend to have these kind of nice open forests. But I will say, so when I say low severity for this study, we also did had areas that were low and moderate severity. So that's kind of indicating here, this in some cases, this is what we identified as low severity. So they have, you know, the density of trees per acre on that is pretty low, right? There's only a few. But it's still a forest, right? Okay, so if we refer back to this, of those areas that are experiencing repeated fires, we're thinking about 75% of those we are counting them or considering them resilient, at least in terms of having a good number of seedlings, you know, whether or not they're regenerating to the same type of forest, like that lodgepole pine example, where there's that obviously the density after the subsequent disturbance is much less. But they're still transitioning into forests. Whereas 25% of the sites just had no seedlings at all and really are not likely to become forests. And most of those were high severity areas. Though I will say, or high severity combinations, that while that sounds stark, 25% of the repeatedly burned landscapes are high severity, we had to really seek out those high combinations, right? Because if you remember the previous study I talked about, it's more likely that you're going to be burning at low severity if you had a previous wildfire. So of those fires, of the whole area burned, these high combinations only encompassed about 3% of the landscape. So while it was 25% of our sites, it was only about 3% of the landscape that was at least in that high combination. So if we think about, I know you guys are probably all sick of seeing that nice linear idea of succession, so I thought I'd bring in this nice different figure of succession or resilience. And our hope, is that regardless of what kind of nature throws at it or we throw at it in terms of climate change, that our forests are going to be able to recover to some similar forest structure, right, and maintain their ecosystem properties and services. But as all of these studies showed, there's a decent proportion of those landscapes that are in one of these other three categories, right? Either there's a potential that they're just transitioning to a slightly different forest composition, right? You could think about this as sites where we're seeing a lower density lodgepole pine forest, or we have a removal of one species that used to be on a landscape, but perhaps now we're getting other tree species that are at least used to be in that ecosystem. There's also the possibility that a forest is transitioning to a completely novel or new forest type, right? So perhaps it's transitioning from a moist mixed conifer forest to a dry mixed conifer forest with a completely different community assembly and fire regime pattern. And similarly, there's also a decent proportion of these landscapes. It's not insignificant when you look across our 1,400 sites that are transitioning into kind of a shrubland or a grassland, at least in the short term, right? I can't say that this is what the pattern is going to be over the next 100 years. And in honesty, that's one of our issues when we talk about resilience, is none of us have the capacity to truly understand these ecosystem resilience on the scale that it matters to them, right? If we're talking about a 200-year-old tree, can we really assess whether or not delaying regeneration by 10 or 15 years is detrimental to those landscapes? I don't know. Okay, so are forests resilient? It seems like the combination of wildfires and climate change is accelerating vegetation shifts and vegetation changes. And especially those lower elevation forests are the most at risk, right? But to not be a complete doomsdayer, we are still seeing about 50% of our sites becoming forests, so we're not going to be all managing grasslands and shrublands now. As once forest managers, we'll have some forests, hopefully, in those burned landscapes. Mixed conifer forests do tend to demonstrate some level of resistance, right, with that decrease in subsequent burn severity. Hopefully, if we think about future wildfires going into these areas that have already been once burned, the ability for us to control those fires as firefighters, but also our ability to hopefully see a decrease in ecological effects is there. And I think I briefly mentioned that there's also a lot of studies that have shown that part of the reason that we see more recent fires kind of burning around older ones is because they are good barriers to subsequent fires. And then as we think about management actions that we need to or should take as we go into the future, we need to think about doing those planting and reforestation efforts in areas that make sense, not just where we wish and hope that forests would be, but rather where it can actually do some good ecologically, and where those trees will continue to likely thrive, right? Planting seedlings in at the edge of a ponderosa pine grassland zone is probably not your best bet, but if you plant it a little bit higher up in elevation, you might do okay. As for future things that I think are important to mention, because we always want to keep doing research, we have a hard time thinking about multiple disturbances, especially after trying to stop wildfires and disturbances in general. So I think we're starting to get a little bit better at looking at two disturbances, but it might be beneficial for us to think about this idea, like that figure talked about a little bit, what is this idea of mega disturbances or multiple disturbances acting on an ecosystem, and that the interval between those might be getting that quicker or less. We have a lot of data and a lot of information about the western U.S., especially when it comes to fire. But there's a lot of areas like the eastern boreal, African savannas, and Southeast Asia that we really don't know much about in terms of their disturbance regimes and how those ecosystems might be changing when we think about climate change. And then just to make a plug for long-term studies, because again, as studiers of resilience, we have a hard time actually looking at what's going on many years down the line, right? But that's going to be important however we do it, whether it's modeling or some repeated measure studies in areas that there's been some historical data to better understand where our forests are headed. And then, of course, as that first study shows, that we are seeing effects of climate change already. And so we need to think about not just how a single ecosystem or single site is transitioning, but how fire regimes in general are shifting in the face of climate change. And with that, I've got lots of people to thank. Most of those names I think I said before, so I won't go into it too much. And then all this work was funded by the Wildland Fire Science Partnership, Joint Fire Science, and the Rocky Mountain Research Station. And with that, I'll take any questions. Hopefully I didn't bore you as much as I look bored here.
You mentioned the conversion to grass stands with severe fires. I think we've seen that. But I think where we've seen it more is where we've had extensive severe fires, extensive in the area. For example, the Hayman fire,
right,
where we have pretty much shrub and grasslands, and it's only recovered where we planted trees. So did you look at areas, is how much that affected that, or?
So we did, the only metric that we used in these studies to look at that was distance to seed source.
Okay.
And so we didn't look at like the actual patch size. But I would say that for that first study where we looked at the two different time periods, for our sites, we didn't have an increase in the patch size or in the distance to seed source. But that became a less important variable in determining whether or not you had seedlings because of climate, or at least that's what it seems like because of climate.
So
were the driest portions of those forest types. So that was kind of what we were trying to get at in terms of that 3-year post-fire climate, since that was looking at, you know, if you are generally a wet site, was those 3 years post-fire also wet, and how did that influence? We didn't really, I would say, capture your question completely of whether or not there were differences between forest types. But with that metric, there was not. The pattern was still the strongest in the dry forest types. Because I think it's our metrics, right? So we weren't looking for if it was recovering to the same species, just if it was recovering to the same density. So I think if we got into the actual species diversity or species type of seedlings, we might see that. But just as a raw density, there wasn't a difference in those higher elevation types. Yes?
Your undisturbed line on your grass, part of the study, was an assumed thing. It seemed like in 2000 you might have had a plateau in that line.
Yeah, the question was, is that 2000 or that white undisturbed line actually part of the study, and that linear line may be actually be different? And no, that was just simply to graphically show it. I wasn't trying to, we weren't trying to compare it to some undisturbed site, undisturbed state, but whether or not they had, you know, our metric for whether or not it was continuing on that similar successional trajectory was just if the seedling density met that threshold. Yes?
I have a
Yeah, so we really struggled with what to compare, what to set that density threshold at, and we even tried to get like stocking rates from all the national forests, and then we called the Flathead National Forest, and the silviculturist there was like, you're doing what? And you're trying to study ecology? Why are you comparing it to a stocking threshold? Like, this is ridiculous. So we kind of stopped that idea. If someone who we're hopefully trying to share information with is saying that our metric is kind of ridiculous, we're going to switch courses. We didn't look at like the potential for those, the carrying capacity or something for those sites, but that's a good other option. It was just we did look at whether or not we set that threshold at like at stand density pre-fire up to 200% of stand density pre-fire, and it didn't change the significance at all. So basically that tells us that most of the sites either have no or hardly any seedlings, or they have a ton of seedlings, and there's very little that's kind of in that margin, right? So they're either regenerating really well and there's hundreds of thousands or thousands, or there's hardly any. So, yeah.
Do you know of any research going on with non-fire related repeat disturbances or like insect outbreak and nidifying?
Yeah, so there, the question is about insect outbreaks and or are there other disturbances that people are looking at? There's a lot of research that's come out pretty recently about bark beetles and fire interactions.
Most of what I've seen is like fire and then bark
beetle. One of the studies that I didn't talk about here, I looked at the opposite. So I looked at bark beetles and then wildfire. In terms of recovery post-disturbance, there was no difference. So if you had a bark beetle outbreak followed by a wildfire in pretty close succession, there wasn't an impact on those seedling densities. So, and fuels, I think the fuels were a little bit lower actually in the bark beetle areas, affected areas. But there's not a whole lot, partly because it's really hard to go back and look, you know, if an area is already burned, to look at areas to determine how much bark beetle activity was there. You know, it was quite I think that was the hardest part of that study, was finding places that we could confirm and verify had bark beetle activity before the fire. So, yes?
Did you look at land use history preceding the fires?
Yeah, so did we use land use history? We did for, I can't speak to all of the studies, but I know for at least half of the data that was a part of that big study, they're in areas that had not previously experienced any large management actions, whether that be logging or salvage logging after those fires or planting or anything like that.
How about in terms of fire exclusion?
So for the most part, they all had experienced similar fire exclusion. We're talking about areas that were in national parks or national forests, that the fires that we showed were the first large wildfires since at least the last 50 years, but more like 100 to 120 years. Yeah.
How do you take some of these lessons from areas that have burned and apply them in terms of promoting the resilience of areas that haven't burned yet? And how does that work into sort of management decision making and setting desired conditions and that type of stuff? So how do those lessons translate over?
Yeah, that's a great question. So how do the lessons from burned areas translate into unburned areas? And I think that in general, a lot of the research that I've done and it has shown that we need to be more aggressive in our management actions, especially in those dry forest types. To not be worried about only having 5% tree mortality, because that's probably not changing the density enough for it to matter, you know, for it to increase its, let's say, resistance to a subsequent fire. But more like up to 50% mortality might be about the densities that we hope for in terms of like a carrying capacity or pre-European settlement densities in a lot of like ponderosa pine forests. I think that's the main one I can think of. I'm trying to think of others. I might have to get back to you on that. But yeah.
Sort of the opposite question. So what's so bad about a shrub or grassland?
Nothing, I don't think, except that we, as managers of national forest. We hope that we're those most of those areas are will continue to be national forests.
I'm curious if on some of these places it might be worth, instead of considering them as deforested, considering them as regrassed, you know, and starting to say, maybe we need to work on building resilience in these grassland shrubland communities instead of sort of throwing up our hands and saying, now it's grassland, now we're walking away. Are there sort of boundaries where you think that's the appropriate course of action?
Yeah, I think so, definitely. One of the people who was a part of that first study, Carrie Kemp, she has a really interesting paper on lower tree lines, looking at like how those are kind of moving up, thinking about, which is an odd idea. I'd never thought about tree lines as a lower edge, but of course there is one. I think we can think about kind of management actions in those lower tree lines if we want to promote a certain ecosystem type, because certainly right now, at least in Idaho and Montana, where she was doing that study, they're pretty much transitioning into cheatgrass grasslands. there's certainly a lot that you could do for restoring those areas. I'm just, you know, I tend to do a lot in trees, so I'm biased in that way in terms of the management actions I think about. Yeah.
So he's also biased that way. Cheatgrass would be a good answer to why you don't want to convert it to grass and shrublands. But I think we are also looking at, when we look at riparian areas, we're looking at temperature gradients for fish and things like that. So I think there are some things that, and you would also say if forests had evolved there, perhaps there's a reason why. It's the same argument you say, well, so what if a species disappears? We've got new species there.
Well, but the counterpoint is that 50,000 years ago, it may have been a grassland. At that point, it would have been
a
forest that was the dangerous condition to keep
it. But I would say as many people as he had here today, 50,000 years ago, is pretty not
germane. Yes?
As for what I've seen in the field, the water quality issues are the biggest problem. I mean, where you had forest, it was really protected, and where the grassland, I was in the Hayman Park quite a bit, and zero region.
Yeah.
Water quality is a huge issue. Where 50,000 years ago there was no reservoir it was feeding into, so there wasn't a problem, but it is now.
Well, and you can even think about water quality as not just the human aspects of that, right? There's lots of wildlife species that depend on those riparian areas maintaining. And that's certainly true for a lot of these lower elevation sites, at least in Idaho and Montana. They were talking about these huge elevational gradients. Right, let's see, I think I have one of those pictures I showed. This is looking off into the Middle Fork of the Salmon, if anybody likes to raft. It's a great place to go. And this fire burned all the way to the bottom and all the way back up the other side. So when we're talking about that transition zone, it's all in the same fire. It's just whether or not it's really down on some of those elevational gradients. And yeah, but I think promoting healthy ecosystems in all ways and accepting that there is going to be, that we are not going to have the same forest that we did before, and figuring out what that means for us as our own values is important. Yes?
Maintaining forests also takes into consideration all the other men, especially when you're considering water quality, because water flows. And so it takes into account not only multiple ecosystems, but multiple management strategies. So if you eliminate forests, then you have to adjust not just your management strategy for a given ecosystem, but all ecosystems that might be impacted as a result of that ecosystem.
That's a great point.
It's just better to organize yourself, hoping to maintain the plan.
It's hard to accept, right? I mean, I started studying forests started natural resources because I love big trees. So it's sad to see them all go. But, and I know everybody has a different story as to why they're outside loving it, but.
Any more questions for Camille? Let's give her another thank you.